Shalom, 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 shalom. Once again, and now under the sounds of the voice of your brother, Kahan Tazadok, coming at you through the spirit, righteousness, and truth. And I just want to say, first of all, giving all praises to the God of our forefathers, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For the record, just to make this very clear, this is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel, and then please be advised. Like everything I'm about to give you, strictly for educational, informational, and entertainment purposes only. It should not be taken as legal advice. Therefore, if you use any of this information, it's just basically information that I'm giving you, and you fall flat on your face, it's your own fault, because I always tell you to go and research everything that I say. As a matter of fact, I dare you to go and research everything that I say. I want you to prove me wrong. And I've yet to find one able to do that yet, because I give you the facts. So with that being said, I wanted to talk to you about how to unplug from debt, how to unplug from commercial debt by properly understanding House Joint Resolution 192 and Public Law 7310, Chapter 48 Statute 112. Might want to write that down and go and look it up. And so, why am I doing this? Because many of you, you're not having success with the acceptor for value. And you know why? The reason, I'm going to tell you why it doesn't work for you. You got people that's calling themselves gurus, right? And they don't understand it. They don't understand the House Joint Resolution, and they listen to naysayers. And they don't understand the public law. But I'm going to touch on both of those, most high willing. But the first thing I want to say to you is John 8 and 32. And you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. And all you fake sovereign gurus, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you mad, because you've been teaching a lot of people lies. You damn YouTubers. That's why a lot of you YouTubers. I watch some of the stuff that you're telling people, man, and it hurts my brain that people would go for some of that madness that you're trying to push. But nevertheless, the truth will make you mad, then make you free once you admit that you lied to everyone. But so I'm going to start by saying Yahushua, God Almighty, is definitely not silent on the subject of debt. See, a lot of you, when I first started doing this, right, a lot of people would say, yo, Tazada, how can you be so intelligent and you still talk that Bible stuff? You had a lot of Moors that said that. You had a lot of people in Egyptology that said that. But guess what? The Bible, when you read it and you properly understand it, most people don't understand the Bible. The Most High does not want us to be in debt. This whole walk right here is spiritual. This is why most people don't get it. The Most High God is definitely not silent on the subject of debt. The Bible gives instant after instant after instant in which the Almighty miraculously cancels the debt of his people, Yasha'Allah. Facts, facts, facts. And you can like it, understand it, believe it or not, but I'm going to give you some scriptures and prove it. So in fact, the Holy Bible has more to say about the cancellation of debt of the people than it does about people's eyes being open. Than it does about people being lame and then being able to walk. See, the word of God actually speaks of debt cancellation from cover to cover, from Genesis to Revelations. All you got to do is be able to understand it. So listen to the words that God is about to speak to you today through Tazadok. This is God's work. It's not mine. I'm just a messenger, baby. Now, listen to the message clearly, and you can live debt-free. Now, remember I talked about those first stones? If you guys hasn't seen the other videos, I highly encourage you to go back and look at the two videos that I done on Accepted for Value, because yours is not working. Only about 1% of you are actually able to get those to work. So remember I talked about the five stones that David had, and I broke down that Goliath in the Ibrit was Goliath, which actually meant to make nude, to strip someone nude. And that's what debt does to you. It makes you nude. Now, let's talk about the first stone, because David had five clear stones that he pulled out of his brook. If you don't know the story, go back and read it in 1 Samuel. Nevertheless, or go back and watch my videos. So this first stone you must lay hold of is, we're going to call it the information stone, right? We're talking about those five stones that David had. And this information, we're going to call it right knowledge. See, the Most High has three important pieces of information that you most firmly fix in your mind. What are those three parts of information? It's important that you fairly understand each of these principles. This is why acceptance for value don't work. And this is why you go to college, you get a degree, and you're still in debt. Most of the people that graduate from college, if that was the answer, right? Everyone that graduate from college, they would tell you, hey, I'm debt-free now, man. I can live. But that's not the case, is it? They're living from paycheck to paycheck, and they got these student loans. They got these mortgage debts over their head. They got the car loans, because everyone is like a cookie cutter. You follow everyone else. Why not follow the truth now? Your way is not working. It's time to try something else. And so as soon as you do follow these principles, you will immediately begin to feel the energy of Yahweh Bahasham, Yahweh Shah, God in Christ, into your own debt program. Understand that. Please believe me. Believe me. I'm not making this up, man. Because you know what? Where you were, I was sitting there a few years ago. So, and these are not just idle words, brothers and sisters. I got better things. This is real enabling power. God's power will flow from God into your life. And so to all of you people that's into the Egyptology and you Moors and you, all of you other people that want to denounce the Most High, it's not going to work for you, man, because your conduit is hell. This is really a spiritual thing. I'm not just saying this, man. You understand? See, I hope you're aware that power does flow from Christ to man. There are a number of scriptural references that prove this fact. So if you remember, God's power flowed when the woman with the issue of blood touched the hem of the Lord's garment. How many of you know that story? She touched the hem of his garment. So as soon as she touched the truth, which was HaMashiach, Yahweh Shah, the one that you call Jesus Christ, power flowed from him to her. So it was the kind of power she needed, for it instantly healed her body, stopping her flow of blood. Stop me where I'm lying. Stop me where I'm lying at. Tell me I'm lying. That's the Most High's guarantee. So HaMashiach, Christ, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, and turned him about in the press and said, who touched my clothes? That's the book of Mark, chapter 5 and 30. You can go and read it for yourself. I'm not making it up. So in that same way, good brother, sister Zelda, praise Para, you know, whoever it may be, Dork Matter, sister Gabby, VG, in the same way, the power that you need will flow from God directly into your life. You got to first believe it. Each of these truths from God's word will release a burst of divine power into your debt, or should I say, your out of debt program. Remember yesterday I told you, you had to come up with an out of debt program. So the three truths you must know are these. Watch this, right? Number one, God is a debt-canceling God. I told you this yesterday. Number two, God is no respecter of persons. If you haven't watched the videos yesterday, go back and watch it. Number three, God wants you to be debt-free. Now, you like that, understand it, believe it or not. But if you don't believe it, it's not going to be effective for you. You understand? If you don't believe it, it's not going to be effective for you. So it goes without saying. Check this, right? It goes without saying that God Almighty can do anything. The Bible clearly states he can. Book of Jeremiah 32 and 17. Lord God, There is nothing too hard for thee. That's Jeremiah 32 and 17. So there could be no question about it. Yahweh Shah, the one that you call Jesus Christ, can cancel debt. So with this truth stated, let me go on to say this: simply knowing God can cancel debt, it will not release any significant amount of God's power into your out-of-debt program, will it? But let me explain what I mean. Let me give you a, let me try and paint a picture in your mind. Let me give you an illustration, right? Let's say you needed $200,000, right, to buy a house. It goes without saying, Yahweh Shah is capable of causing a plant in your garden miraculously to grow $1,000 bills. Is that going to happen? No, man, that's not going to happen. That's not going to happen. Is your garden going to grow $1,000 of bills instead of leaves? Now, he could allow 100 of these $1,000 bills to flow into your money tree miraculously if you want to believe in folklore. So, but he can give you the knowledge on how to ascertain this. Because he said he's not doing stuff like that for you anymore. He said this wicked and adulterous generation want a sign. I'll give you the sign of Jonah being in the well for 3 days. He said, you're not getting no more signs, man. So these are the three things you must know. No one in his right mind would dare to say that, you know, miracles from God is impossible unless they're just a disbeliever. That, you know, only the disbelievers say these are impossible to perform. And then you got people that come on like the brother Polite and say, ah, yeah, you spooky. And, okay, well, you're just not spiritual. That's what that really is. Especially when you know that he has done stranger things before. In fact, he's called a donkey to speak. Read the book of Numbers 22 and 28. But you know what? Someone that's carnal, they won't believe that. And acts hard to swim, right? 2 Kings 6, verse 6. And oil to multiply. 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 5 and 6. However, knowing God is able to do these things does not mean that he will do it. You understand? Do you understand? So the first piece of information that you must know is that God is capable of canceling out your debt. You got to believe that. If you don't believe, it's not going to work. You must know he has canceled debt before. So let me take you through the word of the Most High, right? And show you some of the many miraculous debt cancellations God has performed in the past so that I could try and get you to believe some of these things. Because one of your problems is your mind state, your belief. You really don't believe this, right? So let's talk about a widow's debt is canceled. Book of 2 Kings, right? You got a Bible, you can follow me along. 2 Kings 4 chapter, verse 1 through 7. Go and read it for yourself. So the Most High supernaturally introverted and canceled a widow's debt. Now, he did it the same day her two sons were to become servants of the lender. Go and read the story for yourself. You will find the account of this miracle of debt cancellation in the fourth chapter of 2 Kings. The scriptures tells us the poor woman's husband had died. So while the scriptures doesn't specifically give the cause of the death, it could well have been the pressure of the debt that was bringing him down. Because worrying him will destroy you. It will kill you. It will start to cause physical problems in your body. So the scripture goes on to tell us her two sons would have to spend many years at hard labor paying off the daddy's debt. Some of you know the situation. Someone dies, they tell you, okay, you got to go to probate court. Your father died on this. So in a desperate last minute attempt, the widow turns her man, she turns to the man of God for help with her financial problems just moments before it was too late. So as soon as she tells him of her circumstances, he speaks a powerful word of deliverance to her. He tells her she must borrow vessels, many vessels. She must then go into her house and begin to pour her major supply of oil into the vessels she has borrowed. And as soon as she obeys the prophet, the man of God, her miraculous debt cancellation begins to materialize. It is such a powerful miracle that it makes her and her two sons totally debt free and financially set for the remainders of your life. Now, if the Most High done that then, why don't you think he could do it now? Oh, ye of little faith. See, her little pot of oil miraculously multiplied into many gallons of oil. Listen, as her man of God tells her to sell the oil, pay her debt, and use the surplus for retirement. That's all I'm saying. Come up with a plan. You have to have a plan. Go, book of 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 7. Say, go sell the oil, pay the debt, and live thou and thy children of the rest. So he's saying, live for the rest of your life or for the surplus. You understand what I'm saying? You have to have a plan. So carefully notice that the day the devil intended to be her worst nightmare, the Most High God Almighty turned it into her best day. All of this activity took place because she knew her God was a debt-canceling God. So when she turned to Yahweh Shah, God, for help with her debts, instead of turning to the lender, instead of turning to the Illuminati, instead of turning to the banksters, instead of turning to a lawyer, she released the power of God into her get-out-of-debt program. She did not have to face the evil day alone. She took her debt problem to God in faith, believing he was a debt-canceling God. Her belief paid off when her debt-canceling America became a reality. Now, why do you think the same thing can't happen to you? It's because you don't believe. You don't have the right mindset. You keep listening to the naysayers. So I want you to say the following thing. Why? I'm not joking, man. Why am I telling you this? Because this is what I did. These are the strategies that I use. I came from being broke, homeless. I'm not asking anyone for anything today. I've been working for myself, man, since 2009. I haven't worked in the system since 2009. Understand that. I'm not asking anyone for anything. I'm not asking for any handouts. So I want you to say the following sentence. I'm trying to help you to get your mind right so you could like it, understand it, believe it or not. You could do it or not. But if you want to live debt-free, I want you to say the following things out loud. Yahweh Shah, Christ, my God is a debt-canceling God. Say that to yourself. Say it out loud. You got to believe it. 2 Kings 6, chapter, verse 5 through 7, a borrowed axe head swims. Do you understand? So, again, the life of a young man, right, who had actually has lost an axe head in the river. I'm going to another story now, but canceling out debts. I want you to go and read this, right? 2 Kings 6, chapter. You should be writing this down. Verse 5 through 7, right? When he talks about a borrowed axe head swims, right? So it goes into the story, you know, we find another miraculous debt cancellation. It takes place in the life of a young man who had actually lost an axe head in the river. So the thing that makes the loss of the axe head so important is that it was not just any old axe head. So the scriptures tells us it was a borrowed axe head. That means someone loaned it to him. So that means if he lost it, guess what? He got to pay for it. Alas, master, for it was borrowed. Book of 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 5. Now notice the first thing that the young man does. He calls out for help from God Almighty. It would have seemed as if he should have, like, call for the best diver, right? To go in and find that axe in the river, right? Or maybe the best swimmer to see if he can help him find that axe. However, he doesn't do that. Instead, he calls on God. See, his action leads us to believe he knew his God was a debt-canceling God. But you don't believe. Most of you can't. You don't believe, but you're wondering why the acceptance value don't work. Listen, man. I'm not like these other people, man. I'm not going to tell you you're going to do this thing without God. And if you don't believe this is spiritual, guess what? It's not going to work for you. And it's probably why it's not working for you. You're caught up into all of these different philosophies, man. I'm a different kind of man, man. I understand nothing I do is by my own accord, man. It's through the spirit of Yahweh Bashem, Yahweh Shah, through the spirit of God in Christ. So I want you to please notice that the prophet also believes God to be a debt-canceling God. As soon as he hears that, it was a bold act. The man of God, he moves into action, right? And the axe head miraculously swims to the surface. Now I want you to think of that, right? Axe head made out of steel, right? How is that axe head going to swim to the surface? Had to be the gift of God, man. An iron axe head. Did it swim? And he just put out his hand and took it? 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 6 through 7. Go and read it for yourself. See, don't you just know this young man went home rejoicing that the Most High canceled his debts? I want you to think about it. A miracle from God Almighty set him free of the pending debt of the axe head. The same Yahweh Shah, right? The same Christ who caused the borrowed axe head to swim from the bottom of the river is also your God. You just don't believe it. You just won't keep his laws, so he's not showing you the same miraculous event. And he's a debt-canceling God. I need you to please say it out loud again. My God is a debt-canceling God. A nation becomes debt-free. $1,000, is this possible for the whole nation? Well, a lot of people say, well, yeah, we Israel, we're supposed to be rough. We're supposed to be in captivity. I don't buy that. What about the book of Nehemiah? Go read the book of Nehemiah, the 5th chapter, verse 1 through 12. An entire nation becomes free. See, in the days of Nehemiah, debt has actually risen to unbelievable levels. It was a day much like today, right? Most of our people, where you at? You're in damn huts that they call ghettos. You're on EBT cards. You see what I'm saying? You're in all kind of debts. That's how the days of Nehemiah was. So the nation was deep in debt. People was borrowing, just like you today. How you go to college? You got a damn student loan. Stop me where I'm lying. Stop me if I'm lying. You got a student loan. That's how you went to college. Unless you're really, really in the hood, you put you in a community college. Unless you were so-called educated. And then they'll try and give you an academic scholarship. And they want to turn you into someone that's going to actually destroy your people. You know, a biologist or something, so they could use you to develop some biological warfare or something like that. You see what I'm saying? They put you in some sort of special thing and turn you into a damn human weapon. You understand? So the nation was in deep debt, just like you today. You borrow these loans. You want something? Go and borrow a loan. Oh, yeah, you want a house? Oh, that's such a beautiful house, Mr. Johnson. Okay. Oh, yeah, sure. We're going to give you the loan. Yeah, $250,000 with interest. Pay for it over 30 years, 40 years. Okay, it's okay. You're going to be paying $500,000. No problem. You got your house. We're going to foreclose you in a couple of years, and we're going to find the next sucker to go along. Same thing was going on during the time of the prophet Nehemiah. The nation was in deep debt. People were borrowing because the severe problems that they was facing. Sounds something like this, right? This Goliath that set up. This government, government's like Goliath, a big giant that everyone fears, right? So it's a Goliath, right? So we have actually mortgages, right? You got mortgages you can't afford. In the time of Nehemiah, they had mortgaged their lands, the vineyards, and the houses. That they had to, you know, they had to do this to buy corn just to eat. because of the drought. Go read Nehemiah 5th chapter, verse 3. So not only that, but they were also borrowing money to pay their taxes to Caesar. So when we read Nehemiah, the 5th chapter, verse 4, it says, we have borrowed money for the king's tribute, and that's upon our lands and vineyards. That means taxes, just like they're taxing you today. 40% now of what you make, guess who take it? You're paying the king, Donald Trump. So this same thing is happening right now. Stop me where I'm lying at. Stop me if I'm lying. The same thing is happening right now. The scriptures are overlaying themselves, repeating themselves, right? Many are having to borrow to pay the IRS. Some of you in the room right now, in the sounds of my voice, you got to borrow to pay the IRS, right? You got to do it. Some of you got to do it. Some of you got to borrow to try and pay child support. They're going to lock you up. However, as grim as all this seems, good brother, good sister, it's just a small problem to the Most High. It's brought a small problem that the Most High could actually help you solve. So Nehemiah moves in full confidence that the Most High, the God of Israel, is a debt-canceling God. He commands the lenders to cancel the people's debt and let them free. This is Nehemiah, stand up bold. Tell the docs kind of like the Nehemiah today. So miraculously, God leads all the lenders to forgive the whole nations of their debts. You got the same thing. You don't know how to use it. It's called House Joint Resolution 192. It's called Public Law 7310. Chapter 48, Statute 48.112. That's what it's called. Every one of God's children becomes debt-free in a single day during the time of Nehemiah. Nehemiah, pray you, the lenders, leave us off the usury. Restore, I pray ye, to them, even this day, their lands and their vineyards and their olive yards and their houses, also the hundredth part of money and of the corn and the wine, the oil that ye extract of them. Then said they, we will restore them and will require nothing of them. So will we do as thou sayest. That's the book of Nehemiah, chapter 5 through 12. Go and read it for yourself. I can't make this up. So if you have faith and you don't doubt, this could work for you. It is what it is. It could work for you. It is what it is. Say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and thou cast into the sea, and it shall be done. That's the book of Matthew, chapter 21, dirty fairy. It's Matthew. Go and read it for yourself. Go and read it for yourself. See, the Bible tells us that the prophet Nehemiah became debt-free when they believe in their debt-canceling God's ability to deliver them. How many of you believe that? You believe more in the de facto. You fear the de facto. Hamashiach Yahawashah, the one you call Jesus Christ, has a debt canceled. Book of Matthew, chapter 17, verse 24 through 27. Read it for yourself after the video. So the next picture I want to paint into your mind, right? Watch this. Is that the Most High's debt canceling power comes into the New Testament. The debt will, you know, watch this, right? The debt we will now see canceled is a tax bill. You see how the IRS be taxing you? Well, Mr. So-and-so, you owe $10,000 in taxes, and so on and so forth. Okay, roger that. Roger that. Send me the bill. A large number of God's chosen people, Yasha'Allah, right now you're facing delinquent taxes. Many of you write me. One sister was scared to death scared to death. She's calling me for coaching, but she's afraid to do what I told her, you know, I would do. What's the point in the call? But many of our people, many of you in the sounds of my voice right now, you're facing delinquent taxes. You email, you call. But why not ask the Most High to cancel the tax bill? Praise be the Most High, Yahweh. Why Yahweh Shah? He most surely does. Better than that, he most surely has. He's done it before. The scriptures tells us that God canceled a tax bill for someone whom we all know and love. He did it for our Lord and Savior, Yahweh Shah, the one that you call Jesus Christ. See, the account of this miracle debt cancellation is in the 17th chapter of Matthew. Read it for yourself. There, we will find the tax collectors confronting Simon Peter, the rock. The tax collector asked him if Hamashiach, they call Christ, right? Yeshua, whatever dialect you want to use, Yeshaya, Yahweh Shah, is going to pay his taxes. That's a tribute money, right? Simon Peter immediately tells them, this man, Christ, most certainly is. So as Peter leaves the tax collector to get the necessary cash from the treasury, our Lord sets into motion a miracle of debt cancellation that pays off both of their tax bills. Go read it for yourself. Now I want you to notice that Christ deliberately prevents Simon from proceeding with his plan to use cash like you want to do, like they tell you to do. Hey, well, we want you to pay with Federal Reserve notes. Well, okay. Well, looks like to me, Mashiach didn't use that. He didn't let Peter use that. He wanted to keep it on the private side. But a lot of people think this is not spiritual because you really don't understand. He didn't want Simon Peter to use the cash that was reserved for the ministry. That's for us on the private side. So what did he do? Hey, he accepted their offer for value and he discharged it. He discharged the debt. That's the power of all praises to Yahweh by Hashem, Yahweh Shah, man. All praises due to Yahweh by Hashem, Yahweh Shah. Book of Matthew, the 17th chapter, verse 25 said, and when he came into the house, Hamashiach prevented him. You're not conducting anything from this treasury, Peter. We're not paying them in cash. This is for the ministry. Instead, Christ sends Simon on a fishing trip. Now I want you to please notice, please pay attention that it's a special trip. For it is for a single fish. Oh man, what a miracle. What a miracle that would be. For it would actually have money in its mouth. Stop me from lying. Go out to the sea and cast a hook and take up the fish. The fish cometh up. And when thou hadst opened his mouth, thou shalt find a piece of money. Take that and give it unto them for me and thee. That's the book of Matthew, chapter 17 and 27. You don't take anything from this ministry and give to the devil. Do you understand? You could be debt free, man. You just got to believe. You just got to have faith. There it is in black and white. You can read it for yourself. God performed a miracle of debt cancellation. Do you understand? Go ahead and say it. Say it out loud. But this time, say it as you really mean it. Say it as you really mean it. My God really is a debt canceling God. You got to say it like you mean it, man. You got to believe it. Why? Repetition is a mother of learning. You keep saying it in your mind, guess what? You're really going to start to believe it, and you're going to start acting that out. You got to live that out, King. You got to live that out, Queen. You will find many other miraculous debt cancellations throughout the Word of God. Do you understand? Let me give you a few more instances, right? before I start talking about this House Joint Resolution and public law, right? To establish this truth in your heart, which is your mind. Your heart is your mind. Your real heart is your mind. See, your God goes well beyond just being able to cancel debt. He is, in fact, the God who cancels the debt of his people time and time again. Let me give you a few more Bible counts, right? Philemon, right? Chapter, I'm going to put this in the room because this book is so small in the Bible, most of you probably won't even be able to find it. So let me just specifically post this one in the room, the scriptures, just so you can talk about what was that one. Okay, there was a slave, Onesimus, right? Was set free from debt. Philemon, chapter 10, verse 19. King David's father also became debt free. 1 Samuel 17 and 25. The entire nation of Yasha'Allah, the entire nation of Israel, had all of their debts canceled every 7 years. The debt cancellation took place at the time we call the year of release. Go and read it. Book of Deuteronomy, chapter 15, verse 1 through 2. Go and read it for yourself. At the end of each 50-year period, Israel had a special debt cancellation party. How come y'all don't do that anymore? Why don't you do it anymore? Because you're all in debt. It was called the year of Jubilee. You do it, but you don't know where you do it. And to all, you know, Israelites out on the street, I hate the white man. So why aren't you teaching people this kind of truth, man? That's going to save their life. That's going to make a difference in their life instead of standing on the damn corner talking about how much you hate Esau. Oh, yeah, Esau. But how's that working out for you? How's that working out for you, man? Sounds like to me you're just changing places with the same evil people that condemn you. How does that make you any better? Just something to reflect on, man. Just something to think on. But nevertheless, man, do something productive for the people. You understand? So the entire nation of Israel had all of their debts canceled every 7 years. Do you understand? And at the end of each 50-year period, Israel had a special debt cancellation party. It was called the Year of Jubilee. It's the Jubilee. Any Israelites in the room? Prove me wrong. Prove me wrong. Any Kahans? Any Morays in the room that want to call yourself a priest but really don't know the scriptures? You tap dance with the scriptures? But when you look at them in the Hebrew, total different meaning. Nevertheless, at that time, creditors, and I'm a secure party creditor, Jimmy Alicia, secure party creditor, Bronx, New York. Nevertheless, at that time, creditors cancel all debts and return all the properties to the original owners. Don't believe me? Go and read it for yourself. Go and read the book of Leviticus, the 25th chapter. I'm giving you the law. I'm doing the most difficult thing for you. I'm giving you the law and giving you the remedy. All you got to do is apply it. All you got to do is study it and apply it. You understand? So I want you to say it one more time, family. I want you to say it one more time. My God is a debt-canceling God. You can place that word God with power if you want it. When you look it up, you can say my power is a debt-canceling power. You can place that word with God, with the powers. Should I say, Elohim, the powers. You see what I'm saying? Or you could say God. You want to say it in Greek, English, whatever. You know what I mean? But my Elohim is a debt-canceling Elohim. What you're really saying is my powers is a debt-canceling powers. You understand? So now that you know that the Most High had canceled debts before, I want you to add to this to your knowledge base, that he is the same today that he was yesterday, and he will be the same forever. So with this power, good brothers and sisters, I'm always telling you it's spiritual. Hopefully you could grasp that concept now. So with this powerful combination of truth, you will begin immediately to experience the energy and the spirit, the roar, the energy of the Most High flowing into your get out of debt program. Hamashiach, the same year, he's the same today, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Book of Hebrews, chapter 13, verse 8. Hamashiach, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Book of Hebrews, chapter 13, verse 8. He hasn't changed. He hasn't changed. This Ruach, this spirit, this set apart spirit, the spirit of the Lord is energy release and knowledge, right? So if God has canceled debt before, the Bible says he would do it again. Hallelujah. 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 Your God is still a debt canceling God today. Understand that. He did it before. You can depend on him doing it again. God is a debt canceling God, family. Now, this is the second thing that you must know, right? That your God is no respecter of persons. Of a truth, I perceive that Yahweh Shah is no respecter of person. That's the book of Acts, chapter 10, verse 34. Acts 10 and 34. So you just learn that the Most High has canceled debt before. So if you add to that right knowledge, the fact that God is no respecter of person, you will be able to draw even more of God's power into your get out of debt program. So if you knew the Most High has done something special for a specific individual, you could be assured he would do the same thing for you if you believe and return to his law, statutes, and commandments. He canceled the debt of the widow, 2 Kings 2 and 4. He canceled the debt of the young man who borrowed the axe head, 2 Kings 6 chapter. He canceled the debt of everyone who was with Nehemiah, Nehemiah chapter 5. He even canceled the debt of our Lord and Savior, Hamashiach Yahweh Shah, Matthew the 17th chapter. So if he had people like that by canceling debts, you can be confident that he will be willing to help you with your debts. If he did it for others, he will do it for you as well, because he's no respecter of person. The Most High wants you to be debt-free, brother. The Most High wants you to be debt-free, sister. And the third thing I want to say to you, is before I go into the house joint resolution, so on and so forth, is that when you've learned it, this right knowledge will release even more of the Most High's enabling power into your debt-free program. You must know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the Most High wants you to be debt free, and you must believe that. I want you to notice, I did not say you must know that God doesn't want people to be in debt. I said you must have personal knowledge that God, that actually literally goes beyond this fact, if you want even more of God's power in your get out of debt program. You must know it is God's perfect will for your life that you be totally debt-free. Try this right knowledge, right? Try this right knowledge on for size by saying your name, case in point, in the following sentence, right? Watch this. It sounds like something, you know, trivia, but I'm trying to teach you, man. This is all really psychology and training your mind in the right places, because this is where many of us get stuck, man. Our minds be in the wrong place. Our minds be in the wrong place, and we don't believe. So I want you to try and say the following sentence, but I want you to replace it with your name. God wants Tazadok. You say your name, though, your first name and your last name, Tazadok Shah, to be debt-free. God wants Daryl to be debt-free. God wants Ricky Davis to be debt-free. And repeat that sentence as many times as it takes for it to fill your conscious, right? Because in order to get into your subconscious mind, because this is where the message has to go, you got to constantly keep repeating that to yourself. I tell you what, man, write it on a mirror and look at it every morning, man, and repeat that to yourself. God wants Tazadok Shah, you say your name, to be debt free. So, and just imagine what would happen if you were to stand before the Most High today and ask him how he feels about your debts. I mean, all of it. How would the Most High feel about your debts, your student loans, your car payment, your house payment, your credit card debts, as well as all of the rest of them, your unpaid bills? How would God feel about these debts today? What would he say? What would his reply be? What would he say? I really don't pay attention to your debts. Just use the wisdom and don't overload yourself. What would he say? Or would he say, my precious child, my perfect will for you is that you be debt free. What would he say? See, God's words tells us, you in black and white, what he wants. He wants us to be debt free. I've given you the scriptures to prove it. Please take the time to read the first 14 verses of the 28th chapter of Deuteronomy. I want you to read Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter, and read, and because he wanted blessings to come on us, Yahshua Allah. Read Deuteronomy, the 28th chapter, and stop at verse 14. These are all of the things that the Most High wanted to bless you with. Guess what? You didn't want to keep the laws, like you still don't. So what happened? From verse 15 to the end of the chapter, these damn curses came down on you, man. So I'm telling you, man, you better wake up. This is your only way out of this thing. It's your only way out of this thing. So please take the time to read that, man. In them, you will find that your God says his children who obey him, that keep his laws, statutes, and commandments, would be blessed. He said he would actually send them blessings. Do you understand? Those are only for his obedient children, though. You're not obeying him. You know why you're in debt? Because you're not obeying him. Stop me where I'm lying at, man. You're not obeying him. No matter how much you think you are, if you were, you would be being blessed right now. He said he would actually send blessings that will overtake you. His obedient children. These are his promises. To bless you in every city. How come you're not blessed? Why are you in damn huts called ghettos? Because you're wicked and you're not listening to God. You just pretend. You like to talk. This is why. So the curses came on you. Do you understand? Do you understand? Deuteronomy. He says, their cupboards will be full. Why are you hungry? Why you got a damn EBT card? Why you need food stamps? Because curses are on you. But not on his obedient children. They live in a height. See, the Most High wants you to be debt free. Blessed shall thy basket be and thy store. Deuteronomy 28 and 5. Where are your stores? You don't have any. Why? You're in captivity. He also promises this group that they will have plenty. When I say this group, I'm talking about Yasha Allah, that they will have plenty of nice things. Then why are you in huts called ghettos? The Lord shall make thee plenteous in goods. Deuteronomy 28 and 11. Okay, where is it? You don't have it. The ones who please his will. Do you understand? You will be the head and not the tail. Why are you the tail then? You complaining, the Republicans are doing it. No, God's doing that to you. That was the Lord that did that. That was the Lord that put these curses on you. That was the Lord that allowed you to be in the ghetto. Understand that, man. That was the Lord that's making you suffer like this. Why? Because you're a rebellious and wicked generation. And someone's got to tell you. So I'm going to tell you, man. I'm going to tell you. If you want to get out of your situation, turn to the Most High. Leave these damn philosophies alone, man. Leave these other philosophies and false gods alone, man. You could like that, understand it, believe it or not, but I'm going to tell you the truth, man. But in verse 15 of the same chapter, Deuteronomy makes it very clear. He speaks to the disobedient children, the ones that will not walk in his laws, statutes, and commandments. And instead of blessings, curses come on them. Debt, hardship, bondage, slavery. You understand? Rape, rob, murder. Do you understand? It's crystal clear. Go and read the book, man. Deuteronomy tonight when you get off of when you get off of this court. That and the list of curses goes on and on and on and on. Deuteronomy 28 and 43 and 44, it says, he shall lend to thee. Who? The banksters, the Edomites, the Illuminati. He shall lend to thee, and thou shalt not lend to him. He shall be the head, and thou shalt be the tail. Is that not where you at? That's where you are right now. Do you understand? So I hope you are seeing the powerful advantage of using these right knowledges that I've given you. And so when you know these facts about the Most High and about God's mind on death, will you change? It's a question. Will you change? Will you do the right thing now? So remember what I said to you, good brothers and sisters. Remember what I said to you. So now, What is the plug? What is the plug now that you might be overlooking? Well, the plug is properly understanding, because all of your depth, now not according to Tyler Dock, according to your de facto, is discharged dollar for dollar, right? So the plug is properly understanding and overstanding HJR 192, which is properly called House Joint Resolution 192 and Public Law 7310, Chapter 48, 48 Statute 112. And if you don't know that, write it down. Go to the damn law library like I did and look it up and read it for yourself. You will see that I'm not making this up. You understand? Go to the law library your friggin' self, and you'll see I'm not making this up. Now, before House Joint Resolution 192, and all you debtor haters, I know you're on the call. I know you're on the call. I want you to listen. I want you to prove me wrong, man. I want you to prove me wrong. And all you damn attorneys, all you bar jackass attorneys that be hating because you don't want this truth to spread, because you know you're going to be without a job. You're not going to be able to oppress people anymore. So you're trying to stop this truth. The truth's going to go forth despite who likes it or not. Now, check this out. And I want you to disprove any of it. I challenge any of you to disprove it. Prove me wrong. Now, before House Joint Resolution 192 passed, Executive Order 6102, and you should be writing this down, right, was signed into effect by President Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And as a result of this executive order, this executive order required that all gold and gold certificates be surrendered to the federal government by May the 1st, 1933. Stop me if I'm lying. Okay, I continue, because none of you can stop me unless you're a hypocrite. So House Joint Resolution 192 was then passed by Congress on June the 5th, 1933. Write it down. Go and check it out for yourself, right? So this law was actually passed to do away with the gold clause. They do away with the gold clause, right? What was the gold clause? Oh, I don't know. Okay, well, listen up. You're going to find out what it was, right? So the gold clause is actually in the Constitution and in all public and private contracts. There was a gold clause. So this was clearly the government warring against the Constitution. But people don't see it that way. But the people just sat around. So when this happened, what did the people do? They sit around. Oh, the government. We could trust the government. Just ask the Native Americans. You could trust the government. So nevertheless, the people sat around and did nothing like you do now, right? So this deprived the people of the power to buy anything of their own, because now there's no real money. So just like now, folks sit around and they're watching the game as a corrupt, slick, smooth, oil-talking politicians sell them a story. Sell them a dream, and they do nothing about it. You see what I'm saying? Oh, yeah, bombing of the World Trade Center. Okay, Patriot Act. Take away all your privacy. You see what I'm saying? Cameras everywhere now on damn, like, telephone lines as you drive through a damn traffic light. They got cameras everywhere. And guess what you do? You just go along with it. All power comes from the people, man. Get your mind right. But you dead or haters, you come and you throw hate at me and you tell me I'm not telling the truth, man. You're bugged out of your damn mind. But don't believe me. Go and check out everything I'm saying for yourself. So 1933 was also when the United States went bankrupt, right? Stop me from lying. But it was not the first time that it went bankrupt. As a matter of fact, the United States was actually far in debt before that bankruptcy. There was two additional times that she had went bankrupt. Once in 1789, forming the Constitution for the states, could actually sign on as a security for the Fed debt. You understand? And then in 1861, again, when the Southern state says no more and wanted to succeed rather than sign on to another pledging of assets to pay the federal government debts. Stop me if I'm lying. Stop me if I'm lying. These are historical facts, man. I didn't make this up. I didn't write the history. They wrote it. I just went and researched it. You understand? Alas, in 1933, with House Joint Resolution 192, they took all the gold, which was true money. And then they took all the property and then instituted eminent domain and property taxes and then divided land titles and instituted the income tax to control the labor of the people. And so what did you do? You sit back, you did nothing. What happened now? Your ass is paying 40% in income taxes and wonder why you're working so damn hard, but you can't have nothing. And so, in addition, House Joint Resolution 192 is when they instituted the birth certificate to control the people and have future American people become the collateral for all the federal government's debt. That's right. I want you attorneys to go and research this, man. You think you're so damn smart? Go and research this. Stop denying it, man. If you when you swear your damn oath, and you know, you swear that, you know, to uphold justice and all of this, man, you are some wicked people, man, to do the things to the people that you're doing. You take an oath to stand up for justice. And the damn scale of justice is blind because we're not getting no true justice because they know what's going on. And this is why I hate people like Tyler Dodd, because I speak the damn truth, man. I tell the truth. And it incenses me, man. You know, you say that guy sounds so angry. I'm just passionate about this, and every when I think about how this is happening and how many of us is in damn slavery, it incenses me. So nevertheless, so your birth certificate is the title to your corpus, your body, and it has actually been pledged as an asset. The holder has the right to the taxes and the fines, the fees, et cetera, that you pay to the government through judgment.
Judgment for the plaintiff.
Judgment against you. Through court cases. You understand? Through payroll taxes. Through income taxes. Through property taxes. Through personal taxes. Do you understand? They're collecting on all these taxes. So from the very beginning, the de facto that you call government was in debt to European banksters, to the Illuminati, to the Zionists. You call them the Illuminati. And as a result of the revolution, right? The First World War. Now, how ironic that we had to borrow money from England to pay for the war that we fought against them. How in the hell are you going to borrow money from... And I want you to go and check this out for yourself. I'm not making this up. How in the hell is America going to borrow money from England to fight a war that she's going to war against them? Something's not right with this picture. You understand what I'm saying? Something's not right with that picture, man. What's wrong with that picture? Now, fast forward to the 1900s, right? And you'll come across several key events that makes it quite obvious that there was a master plan put in place to enslave not just so-called black people, but all the American people that was not part of this small faction of international banksters, of the top 13 bloodlines, and so on and so forth. So there's a book that I read, right? It was entitled that I'll post that in the room. Excellent book. If you want to learn more about this, it was called the, let me post it in the room here quick. This book, you know, you should read it if you respect knowledge like I do, maybe not. But it's called The Creature from Jekyll Island. So I read that book, right? And then I became intimately acquainted with the happenings in the year of 1910, when six men who were either elite banksters or politicians met in a secret place named Jekyll Island. Go and check it out. Jekyll Island. So the purpose of this meeting was to formulate plans for economic reforms for the United States. So this is where the banking cartel began in this country. So the idea of a central bank had always been rejected, right? And so the men who met on Jekyll Island needed to come up with a way to trick the people into allowing the central bank to be instituted. Who was controlling the central bank? The Illuminati. The Illuminati. So 3 years later, in 1913, right? President Woodrow Wilson, right? He signed the Federal Reserve Act into effect. He was a president, but guess what? A man that's responsible for you registering your biological property was his handler. You see how these rappers and these celebrities have handlers? Well, President Woodrow Wilson had a handler, and his name was Edward Mandel House. It was him that deemed using the birth certificate to register your biological property. So in the year 1913, President Woodrow Wilson signed the Federal Reserve Act into effect, which is the current central bank in the United States. Now, even though it is actually not governed by any agency of the federal government. So fast forward 8 years later, right? In 1921, the Maternity Act. Who do they use as a scapegoat? Women, females. So in 1921, the Maternity Act was passed, which require all birth to be registered with the state. So now all the key pieces were in place for the upcoming bankruptcy, default, and reconstruction. You see what I'm saying? So in 1933, the federal government went bankrupt. They passed EO-6102 and House Joint Resolution 192. Check them out for yourself. Don't believe me? Check it out. Don't just check it out. Read them. And pledge us, the people, as a collateral to back the government debt. They made us slaves. But they couldn't technically make us slaves because that would be illegal, right? Because of the 13th Amendment. So they had to give us a remedy. They had to give us a remedy. And that remedy was House Joint Resolution 192. So if you tell me I can't discharge a debt, and you haven't read House Joint Resolution 192, man, to hell with you. To hell with you. You don't know what the hell you're talking about. You're ignorant. And I'm not insulting you. It just simply means you don't know. So it is that government has actually an obligation to discharge and to settle any public debt that we may occur in our daily lives. Yes, this includes mortgages, you understand? Loans, so on and so forth. But wait, The government says, and many of you haters, and many of you attorneys will say, well, wasn't House Joint Resolution 192 repeal? Man, shut the hell up, man. Stay off of this damn channel because you spread a lot of lies, right? And check this out, right? Even if it was, it don't make any difference, right? Now, technically, it was, but the provisions that brought us into having no money of substance still exist and still apply. So it doesn't matter if it was a pill. So in other words, we didn't go back to using real money. You understand? We didn't go back to using gold or silver. And again, there's a maxim of law that states, and maxims of law don't change, right? That whoever brings the obligation must bring the remedy. So whoever brings the obligation must bring the remedy, so it still applies, right? Because we never went back to gold and silver. So the government still has a fiduciary duty to discharge and settle your and my public debts because we still do not have access to money of real substance according to the Constitution, right? And because the U.S. is still in bankruptcy mode. So the Secretary of Treasury is still the receiver in a bankruptcy. So the birth certificate is still a bond and your debts are still prepaid by your future labor, property, and taxes that they are assuming the administration of as the office of the executor of the estate of the old capital letters name, a.k.a. John Quincy Doe, in all capital letters. They've assumed that. Why? Because your mom signed away your rights, or both of your parents signed away your rights. State assumed power of attorney. So they still hypothecated the birth certificate and made billions off of the birth certificate. Or even if you came here from Jamaica, like Dilett, and got naturalized, still make it off you. Or every new citizen. So, in fact, in every court case, over $7,000 to $8,000 there are new bonds created and traded off of your birth certificate estate. Don't believe me? Go and check it out for yourself. Go and check out everything that I'm saying. So, okay. So now that we have this information, right, on House Joint Resolution 192, can I just discharge something according to House Joint Resolution 192 on a bill and call it the day? The long answer is, if you're a secure party creditor, and you understand contract law, the short answer is no, because chances are you are a debtor. And I'm not talking about someone that filed documents but still don't understand contract law. You understand? I mean that debtor mentality, that debtor mind state, right? So the short answer is no. We cannot just simply scribble some words at a 45-degree angle like a lot of these so-called gurus are teaching on the internet across a bill and think that we are done. You don't understand the contract law. And never have to pay with FRN's bills ever again. Doesn't work that way. See, this is why those who are not fully informed, I always tell you to stay the hell away from this, right? This is why those who are not fully informed, they call this HJR 192, right? They call it a scam. They call House Joint Resolution 192 a scam. Why? Because they haven't really thoroughly researched it and they don't understand it. Because it isn't easy. It isn't, whoop, there it is. It doesn't work like that, King. The fact of the matter is, that's just the tip of the iceberg, family. And the rabbit hole runs deep. The problem is, are you willing to go down that rabbit hole? That's the question. The rabbit hole runs deeper than you imagine. So if we really want to change our lives, right, it takes massive amounts of studying, research, experience, and so on and so forth. I tell you to get my books. Most of you won't. Some of you will. So some of you that get them, you won't even read it. I asked one boy, I said, yeah, I haven't read it yet. I asked a brother at the seminar, you got any of my books? Yeah, I got one. How long have you had it? About 2 months. I haven't read it. I'm halfway through it. Okay, well, you want to stay in debt, man. It's a debtor's mind state. I tell you to read a book at least 5 times, man. Why? Because repetition is embedded into your subconscious mind. See, we need to educate ourselves not only on the history of this, how it came about, but also stay on the forefront of these new technologies that we can actually use to change our status and obtain our remedy as close to the 100% mark as possible. Do you understand? Do you understand? So if you are interested in learning more about everything that I've been actually talking about, and the inception of the straw man to the latest and greatest degree, and how to change your status, and how to properly use House Joint Resolution 192, hey, send me an email. Give us a call for coaching, but even better yet, order my books and show up at the seminars. Order my books and show up at the seminars. Now, let me deal with the other thing. Was House Joint Resolution 192 repealed? Was it repealed? Now, I can't even begin to count. I was at a seminar, right? I was doing a seminar in New York last year. Guy, he taught George Abbott a lot. Had a doctorate degree. Well, I'm a black guy, but it's real bougie, right?
Well, yeah, that wasn't a House Joint Resolution on repeal.
And so I'm looking at this guy. I'm like, damn, this Negro didn't just fix his thick, big black lips to, you know, talk from his vocal cord instead of his esophagus. But I'm like, yeah, all right, roger that. I didn't respond to it then. But nevertheless, right, let me address that, right? Because I can't even count the number of times that I've had gullible people of this so-called free man movement, or the so-called Moorish movement, a lot of you Moors, that have blindly believed these patriot and these sheiks and these lodges that's not teaching any of you the truth. I'm not insulting anyone. I'm speaking the damn truth, man. And I don't care who like it or not, right? You believe this mythology without even thinking it through, right? So that's the problem. You're not thinking things through. So these internet gurus, these so-called sheiks, that's not even following the Prophet Nur al-Din Ali. These people who are too damn lazy to do any research or think through a rumor before blindly believing anything that they hear. That's why a lot of you debtors come on my channel and throw around a lot of hate. You blindly believe everything that you hear. Stop watching the damn soccer game, right? Stop watching the damn tennis match. You understand? Stop watching the baseball games. Get off the Xbox and start studying and thinking things through. Now, first of all, House Joint Resolution, as some of you say, HJR 192, is just a short name for House Joint Resolution, right? So let's understand what a resolution is, right? Because it's called aphasia, right? It's called aphasia. Many of you, you don't really understand words. You've lost that ability to properly use words because they're speaking legalese. You're speaking common parlance. And so you don't understand. Same words being used, total different meaning, right? So first of all, let me explain what is a resolution. Now, many of you, if you would be honest, you made a New Year's resolution, right? Do you know what that means? Do you know what that means, right? A New Year's resolution applies to you, right? Z-Light Production, a New Year's resolution applies to you, right? Kinshorn, Westbury, New Year's resolution applies to you, right? But Right. So a New Year's resolution applies to you, the one who made it. It does not apply to the entire United States or anyone else. It only applies to you. You're the one who resolved to get into shape starting January the 1st. You're the one who resolved to stop smoking weed January the 1st. You're the one who resolved to stop drinking on January the 1st, right? Do you understand? Your neighbor, the entire United States, is not obligated to do what you resolved to do in your resolution. Do you understand? So with that being said, I hope I can make this clear, right? House Joint Resolution 192 is strictly a resolution that only applies to the members of Congress who resolved it and its subjects. It can be modified. Who cares if they modified it? It could be modified at any time, but by Congress, right? If they so choose to do so. Just as you can modify your New Year's resolution. Well, I wanted to lose 20 pounds, now I'm going to lose 30. Okay, roger that. However, modifying a public law is a little bit different, right? So this is why I always quote the law with it, right? The law is different. So the law in this instance, per the actual statute at large, is defined as Chapter 48, 48 Statute 112. Let me put that in the room, man. Let me type that in the room. So you can't say that you didn't know where to go for this, man. So it's right there in the room. I want you to go and look it up. Go to the law library. Don't look it up online. I want you to see I'm not making this up. Go to the damn law library like I did, right? So Chapter 48, 48 Statute 112. I went down to the New York University Law Library. All of you in New York, you could go there. 40 Washington Square, South, 40 Washington Square, South, right there in Manhattan, New York, New York, 10012. You could go there. So you can't say you don't know how to get there. I just gave you the damn address to get there. You could get off the damn train at Union Square on 14th Street, the number 6, and then just walk down. Or you get on the 4 to 5, get off at Union Square and walk down. You'll see it. Go to the law library for New York University. So that is where you could go and rule it. Now, what I got to say to you is this, right? And whatever city you're in, go to the law library. Don't look it up online. I want you to see that it's there, that I'm not making this thing up. And there's no way a lawyer can lie to you because you're going to see it in the law library. Now, always do your homework. This is the first thing I'm going to say to you in my conclusion. Verify everything. Don't believe anything I said to you in this video. I want you to verify everything. Matter of fact, I want you to prove me wrong. Prove me wrong. Verify everything. Discern fact from error. Stop listening to people on YouTube, man. Check out everything. Discern the truth from lies. Never act based on someone else's claim. Well, so-and-so, well, Yusef L. Said such-and-so, well, Gene Keaton said, well, to hell with that, man. Go and verify it. Well, Tazza Doc said, to hell with what I say. Go and verify it for yourself. You understand what I'm saying? Verify it. Never act based on someone else's claim. Check out everything that I tell you. And I always tell you, hey, go and check it out for yourself. Not one of you came back to me and said, hey, Tazza Doc, you're wrong. But plenty of you came and said, damn, man, I checked out everything you said. And just like you said, man, it was the truth. I couldn't find any lie because I speak the truth. This is God's work, not mine. So if I refer to House Joint Resolution 192, I'm telling the listener that that's a subject of Congress. And I don't care if they repealed it. What I know is they haven't returned gold back to circulation, right? I'm not a citizen of the United States. I'm not a citizen of the corporation. And so the last thing that I want to say, and I can say that the de facto, the federal GOV has placed insufficient amounts of lawful money in general circulation on purpose. And this is controlled by the banksters, right? Limited amount of gold, limited amount of silver coinage. And thus, since they only have a limited amount in circulation, they're forcing me to discharge my public debts with commercial paper. Do you understand? Putting them off to a future point in time and restricting my obligation as a secured party creditor to pay debts. Do you understand? So I refer to the federal government's obligation to me as Chapter 48, 48 Statute 112, not House Joint Resolution 192. The federal government took away my ability to pay a debt with lawful money. Stop me from lying. But that doesn't make me a subject of Congress or of the federal government. And thus, their resolution don't apply to me. Show me the law. Their resolution don't apply to me. Show me the law. Chapter 48. 48 Statute 112. However, their obligation to me under the public law does apply to me because there is an insufficient amount of money, real money, in general circulation to meet the needs of we the people, which includes me. Do you understand? It's really that simple. Do you understand? So when the federal government took most of our lawful money out of general circulation in 1933, the gold and silver, thus leaving an insufficient amount of lawful money in general circulation to meet the needs of we the people, and then taking silver out later, the Congress was then required to give the people a remedy. The remedy is what? Chapter 48, 48 Statute 112. That is the remedy. That is the remedy. There's your acceptance for value right there. Bam! Woo! There it is. There's your acceptance for value right there. It states in pertinent parts, this is why I want you to read this for yourself. It states in pertinent parts that the federal government will pay my debts dollar for dollar. And I want you to take special attention, right? It doesn't say the government will pay for anything that I desire to buy, like a car. So stop damn contacting me, man, and asking me, well, how come it's not working for my cell phone bill? Is that a damn debt? That's not a debt, man. It doesn't say it would pay. You could go out and buy things with it, man. It says discharge debts dollar for dollar. It didn't say you could pay for anything, man. A reoccurring cell phone bill is not a debt. It has to be a debt. And a water bill is not a debt. Do you understand, man? How difficult is that to understand? You got jackasses that come to my seminar or kind of go to the car dealership, sign it, and then wait about 2 weeks and accept it for value. Negro, please. Why don't you go and study, man, before you hurt yourself? Go and study before you hurt yourself. So only that, you know, it has to be a legitimate public debt. And don't try and do it on the public side. I mean, the private side. Excuse me. Don't try and do it on the private side either, between you and I. So the state constitution required that the state to pay its debts in gold or silver coin. If there's any attorneys in the room, you know I'm telling the truth. The state constitution requires that the debts are paid in gold or silver coins. Stop me where I'm lying. Everybody in agreement? Roger that. Roger that. So by taking away a state government's ability to comply with its constitutional mandate of paying its debts in gold and silver coins, the federal government, the United States, which is a corporation according to 28 U.S.C. 3002 subsection 15A, involuntarily restricted a government's ability to function in a de jure capacity. So now it's a facto, existing in fact, but not officially established. Do you understand? They can't function in a de jure capacity anymore. The de jure states went into suspension. Your states are what now? They're all franchisees of the United States. So they're corporations as well. So the Dazier states went into suspension after following four acts were actually committed. What are those four acts? Number one, taking the gold out of general circulation in 1933. Number two, in 1964, the U.S. Mint ceased minting any more silver coins. Number three, in 1968, silver certificate could no longer be redeemed for silver. And number four, on August the 15th, 1971, Tricky Dick, Richard Nixon, closed the gold window, thus stopping the redemption of foreign held dollars for gold. So at that point in time, the U.S. dollar was backed solely by full faith and credit of the American people. That's your labor, man. And the states could no longer function in a Dazier capacity while in a state of suspension. So all you that saying that you're state citizens and you listen to these sovereigns, you shut up too, because you don't know what the hell you're talking about, because these states are franchisees of the United States and they're all corporations. Do you understand? So the states went into suspension because the federal government involuntarily forced the states to pay its officers, its judges, its employees, et cetera, et cetera. So with something other than gold and silver coins, which was required by the state constitution. Stop me from lying. Am I lying? Okay. I'll continue. Am I lying, Gabby? Am I lying, Gabby? I'll continue. I'm telling the truth, man. I'm telling the truth. So, nevertheless, man, so what we have here, brothers, is pretty much is what's going on today. And this is why so many people are being afflicted. This is why so many people are on the edge. This is why so many people are kept in a state of debt. You don't own anything. You can't own your house anymore. Can't own your land anymore. They've taken away that ability. They've deprived the people of that ability. Do you understand? So, since the federal government took away the gold and coin money in 1933, causing the states to suspend operations by preventing them from honoring their obligation to pay their debts in gold and silver coins, there had to be a remedy. There had to be a remedy. Chapter 48 Statute 112 is the remedy. Not just for the state, but also for the secure party creditor man and woman, to the sovereign man and woman who created the state. The people are the state. There would be no states without we the people. So until gold and silver coinage is reinstituted or reinstated in sufficient quantities for general circulation, that remedy cannot be repealed. That's law. Congress may have repealed some part of House Joint Resolution 192, or even all of it, because House Joint Resolution is merely a resolution for Congress and all of its subjects. What does it have to do with Tazadok? However, the true remedy is provided to the people by Public Law 48 Statute 48.112. Do you understand this, man, yet now? I hope you understand this now. So until the government, the state government, comes out of suspension by the federal government placing sufficient quantities of lawful money into general circulation, your remedy percent, not to Tazadok, I'm not making this up, percent to Chapter 48 Statute 112 cannot be replaced and will continue to be there. The remedy of the subject, the citizens, found at House Joint Resolution 192 might not be there, because their remedy is nothing but a resolution. But the remedy of I, man, and we the people, the secure party creditors, found at public law. 48 statute, 40, public chapter 48, 48 statute 112. It will still be there because that's our remedy, a public law, not a resolution, not a resolution. So if as many uninformed freemen, right, uninformed sovereigns claim the promise of the federal government will pay your debts dollar for dollar is no longer valid, then those so-called free men, those so-called sovereigns have no basis for claiming their remedy by using the 1099 OID. You understand? For the refund of out-of-pocket funds expended to pay their debts. Either you believe that the federal government repealed your remedy and therefore there is no 1099 OID refund process available to you, or you believe the government has an obligation to pay your debts dollar for dollar and therefore the 1099 OID process for a refund is your remedy and you could use it to recover the funds you expended to take care of your debt obligations. You can't believe your remedy has been repealed and then try to claim your remedy by asking for a refund using the 1099 OID process. So now that you understand the difference between a resolution and a public law and why your remedy was given to you after this video, you should understand. If not, watch it 5 more times. You may recall how a well-known so-called, I'm not going to say his name, I'll call him a freedom man attorney or a patriot attorney who specializes in tax matters, you know who he is, has worked hard to intentionally mislead sovereign men and women into believing that their remedy has been repealed. And you guys know who he is, man. He talks a lot about the 1099 OID and you see him on certain shows, man. And nevertheless, I'm not going to put his name out there, man, because, you know, debtors love attention, right? And a man was, he's an attorney. I won't say his name, but they love attention. They love attention. But nevertheless, he's talking about a subject remedy by resolution, not as a secure party creditor, not as a secure party creditor remedy by public law. You see what I'm saying? So please do your homework, people. Stop. I don't care how, what kind of degree someone has or what kind of status. Oh, I'm a lawyer. I'm a Moor. I'm a sheep. Do your homework. Please do your homework and think outside of the box. Think for yourself. Different about Taz and Doc, I don't teach you what to think. I teach you how to think so that you can think for yourself. You understand? Do your homework. Do your homework. Think outside of the box before dismantling, you know, this mythologies that they have going around and then passing it to someone else and then causing that person to stumble when they might have actually gotten a remedy by your lack of research and lack of knowledge, your lack of right knowledge. So if you wish to continue arguing these ridiculous allegations without doing your homework, if you love polemics that much, by, you know, you refusing to spend time required studying the monetary system in detail, then please do it in the private. Stay the hell off of my channel doing it. You know what I mean? Oh, you to come and give the thumbs down and all that? Well, okay, roger that. Thank you for your energy. But I'm not going to engage in polemics with you. To you, your way, and to me, mine. And that's all I really have to say about that. And so with that, I'm going to bring this to a close. And I thank you all for listening. Like this video, share the video. A lot of people could actually use the information in this video. Believe it or not, someone that you know or someone that you know that someone know need this information because they've been going way off course. This is right knowledge. This is God's work. This is not Tazadok's Doc's work. This is the work of the Most High. So I thank you all for listening. I love you, and so I'm just giving you my time and energy because this is what the Most High has ordained me to do, even if it kills me. So with that, shalom.